You're listening to the Sunday Breakfast Show with me, Nighat Arif. Now, it's just coming up to 9 minutes past nine. Passover starts on Wednesday, the eighth day Jewish festival commemorating the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt. It's a festival all about freedom and remembrance and, of course, close to my heart, special food. Many Jews around the three counties will be gathering together and carrying out rituals. One community is the St. Albans Maserati. I'm going to pronounce this wrong, aren't I, again? Maserati Synagogue, which is led by Adam Rabbi Zagoria Moffat, who is with me in the studio. Good morning, Adam.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
I have to say, okay, the listeners can't see you, but you're incredibly young.
Well, not all rabbis start out with a beard and aged and wise.
I Googled you before I knew, and I knew, but you look very young in real life as well. Most rabbis are a lot older than I mean.
It's the lack of a beard, I think. It's definitely, people are surprised. School visits are often surprised.
Oh, right, exactly. They're like, who is this really rock star?
Doesn't look like a rabbi at all.
Can you tell us about your synagogue? How is it different to other branches of Judaism?
Sure. Well, so we call it SAMS for short, partially because it is so hard to pronounce. St. Albans Maserati Synagogue. And SAMS is quite an unusual community in many ways. Maserati Judaism is unusual because it's the smallest group in the UK. And because we're trying to do something which in today's world is really quite unusual, which is we're trying to be kind of radically centrist. So Maserati Judaism is all about moderation, all about being in the middle. If you find that orthodoxy tends to be a bit too much for you and reform and liberal denominations tend to be a bit too little, then Maserati is in the middle and it's just right. It's a bit like Goldilocks.
And I understand you're trying to do something quite different in terms of finance and membership. Tell us about that.
Yeah, true to our whole ethos, I think, about being a bit different and about doing things our own way. We're doing something which is completely unprecedented, practically the first community in the UK. There's a smaller one that's done it before us, but we're doing away with membership dues entirely. And for a lot of listeners who aren't familiar with the way in which synagogues are funded, that might be doesn't sound like a really exciting or strange thing, but actually most synagogues work a bit like a gym in the UK. Members join and they pay a monthly subscription, and as a result they get access to the synagogue and its services and whatever. And it's done that way because it needs to be, because each synagogue is independent and has to be funded by its members. But the result is that it can be a financial barrier sometimes for people, and some people don't join communities because they feel like they can't afford it. So we're trying to address that in a new way.
And how has the change, been the response from the community? Are they amenable to it?
Yeah.
And because you're trying to support, like you say, the cost of living crisis is going up.
Exactly. And you know, we wouldn't be doing it if it weren't coming from the bottom up in the community. And it's really the result of us trying to do something differently. What we call it is member share instead of membership. And the notion is actually, instead of saying, here's what the fee is to be a member of the community, we're saying, here's what it costs to run the community. Here's the monthly per person per cost. Per month per person cost, tell us what you can pay. And some people, of course, thankfully, have the means to pay more than that. Some people don't and have to pay less than that. But this removes all those barriers of having to feel like you're asking for a discount or like you can't afford it, and everyone hopefully can access the community equally.
It's an interesting point that you make, how religious communities support themselves, because I suppose that I hadn't ever thought of mosques, synagogues, temples being businesses in a way, because they have to be able to have the maintenance to allow people to come and worship. There has to be a balance between generosity, duty, faith. Have you drawn ideas from other faith groups as well?
Yeah, to some extent, I think we've learned a lot from Christian communities, from Muslim communities, from communities that rely more on donation. I think that synagogues just have kind of, over time, and it's relatively a new thing in Jewish history, adopted this model of membership, but it's not necessarily the best one. It has its benefits, but ultimately, exactly as you say, at the end of the day, the goal is not to make money. The goal is to keep the lights on and to make sure that we can do what we need to for our members and for our community.
Rabbi Adam, Passover gets underway this week. How will you be celebrating it?
Oof, right now by cleaning. These couple days now are
I
the
like
prep.
You already, the fact that you started with cleaning.
Well, you have to. Passover is all about removing what we call chametz, which is the leavened products in our kitchens and from our lives and from our hearts in some way. And that means you got to start by a pretty rigorous scrubbing.
And how do you market with food? Tell us a little bit about that, because
it's
that's my favorite
food,
topic.
Yeah,
it is all about the food.
Religions all have in common a desire to make holidays about food, and Passover is no different. To some degree, Passover is about what food you can't eat, right? You can't eat all of those 11 products, which means no bread, no pasta, no pastries for a week. You can survive for a week with no pastries. But it means, as a result, we eat lots of other foods, and often symbolic foods at the Seder, the kind of special meal that we have on the evening of Passover, all of which represent the story of the Exodus and our people's history.
Remind us of that story.
Yeah, well, it's familiar to many people, even many who aren't Jewish, because, of course, you know, I go and visit schools and I ask kids if they know who Moses is, and lots of kids raise their hand, but only few of them are typically Jewish in the class. So the story of the Israelites who were slaves in Egypt, who helped build the famous building projects we now see, the pyramids and the Sphinx and ever, and ultimately were liberated by Moses working with God and working to try and draw people to a better future for themselves. You know, that's what we celebrate at Passover. We mark the dark side of it, right? We tell the story, including the plagues, including the death and violence. But ultimately, we see the goal of it to be for us to experience what it's like to be liberated, for us to feel as our ancestors did.
What inspiration do you draw from Passover? I mean, what do you think freedom means for people of faith in the UK in 2023? Because obviously this is a very historic story that we're talking about. Is it still relevant now?
Yeah, in some way we take freedom for granted these days. I think, you know, especially religious freedom, it's something fairly new in history, especially for the Jewish community, that we can just be ourselves living amongst others and be responsible for promoting and sharing and living our faith. So it's, in some ways, harder to understand the Passover story today because freedom is something which we don't really appreciate its difficulty. But I think the story does teach us that freedom is a difficult thing. It doesn't come naturally or easily, and it takes work.
And also, what else are you involved with at the moment within your community and across the three counties more widely? Because you do a lot of outreach work.
I do. I try and get very involved in our local community in St. Albans. St. Albans is a really religious city. It's wonderfully just diverse and energetic, and we have the Abbey and two mosques and 37 churches, I think, and
Wowzers.
Two synagogues. I know and there's always a lot going on. So I try to make sure that our community represents itself well to the civic community. A lot of that comes with education. I do a lot of school visits. Some of your listeners, you know, may have children at home who have had me come around to their school with a shofar.
Probably listen to your voice right now going, oh, that's Rabbi
Adam.
Sounds really familiar, that voice. Because you're very busy now. Tell us about the prayer book you're working on. It's a prayer more of a communal, is prayer more of a communal thing in Judaism rather than something individuals do at home?
It's both, really. I mean, typically Jews will pray three times a day, and you can pray by yourself, but it's better to pray with a quorum of 10 people, called a minyan. So the prayer book itself is actually largely already written. I don't have to do much work for that. But we tend to redesign and republish Siddurim, or prayer books, all the time to update it, to make it relevant to the people living in that time. Language changes and style changes and art changes.
And this year is one of those unique years where, actually, I think last year was similar, where we have the three major festivals of the Abrahamic faiths coming together, Ramadan, Passover, and also Easter. As you were saying earlier, sort of we're very similar with each other. How does that make you feel as a rabbi and then conveying those stories over to your congregation?
I love it. I mean, I think it's really easy to show people how much these three faiths are a family, have a sibling relationship with each other, because it coincides so easily and so naturally. Literally, Rosh Chodesh Nisan, the first day of the month of Nisan, which is the month Passover falls and a very important one to us, was the same day, the same moon, as Ramadan began. And to see next week, we'll have people celebrating Easter and Passover, and, you know, I've got plans to go to an iftar meal after Passover is over and enjoy all the wonderful delicacies there. To me, it really shows the depth of the connection between these three faiths.
Because this year, obviously, with social media, I'm seeing so many churches and synagogues obviously host iftar as well.
Yeah.
And there is this real sense that we are very similar. And I like the analogy that you made, that we are siblings as well, because there is more similarities than what divides us.
100%. Absolutely.
And we need to work on that far more, especially if we're going to have interfaith dialogues and continue to have harmony within our faiths as well. The difficulty I have is that sometimes on Twitter, it can be, social media, but it can be quite a toxic place because there are individuals that will constantly try and divide the faiths. And actually what we should be trying to say is that at Christmas time at the mosque in Chesham, What we always do is we do lots of fundraising for Christmas.
Right.
We commemorate it, although we differ on what actually happens at Christmas. But I think that's okay. Do you think that's all right?
Yeah, of course it is. I think you can appreciate, you know, I teach my son to appreciate and learn about all of the communities around him and see the connections. Because if you're looking for the divisions, you'll see the divisions. And there's lots of people in the world who will only look for the divisions. But if you look for the similarities, there's a lot more there than people realize. And particularly I found that between the Jewish and Muslim communities, people on both sides don't really realize how similar our traditions and how similar we operate and how similar we think about the world. And there's just so much to be done to get people not to pretend everything's the same, not to pretend there aren't differences, but to appreciate what the similarities are and what the differences are and to learn from both.
And with your interfaith work that you're doing, I gather you're doing some interesting stuff at St. Albans Cathedral. Now, what's a rabbi doing in a cathedral? I'm joking.
I mean, I'm there an awful lot, actually. I'm really pleased to be quite well known in the cathedral. Often I'll have family come and visit and I'll be giving them a tour of the cathedral. And, you know, the vicars and canons or the dean of the abbey will stop and say hello. And I think my family is surprised to see that, you know, I'm someone who's known to all of these people wearing cossacks and, you know, the collars and whatever. But it's a wonderful thing for me. I get invited to speak and to teach in the adult education program there and to be there and to be participating in what is really the center of life in St. Albans is a pleasure.
Well, it's been an absolute pleasure having you and listening to all that you're doing and also getting a sense of what Passover is for you at the moment. Rabbi Adam Zagoria Moffat.
Thank you.
Who is the rabbi at St. Albans Maserati Synagogue. Thank you so much
Thank
for
you.
Joining us. How charming was Rabbi Adam? Honestly, he was just so inspirational. Lovely to have him in the studio and also so lovely to hear about Passover. And it's so important every now and then to reflect on the fact there are so many things, and I keep saying this on the show every week that I'm on, there are so many things that unite us than divide us. And if we can just keep focusing on that and keep moving forward, that we are more united than divided, then honestly, wouldn't there be so much more harmony in the world? Erasure sometimes.